A new documentary about the Blennerhassetts, this week on Mid-Ohio Valley Now. Good morning and welcome to another edition of Mid-Ohio Valley Now. I'm your host, Eric Little. Thanks for joining us once again this week, and thanks for making us a part of your weekend routine. This week on Mid-Ohio Valley Now, we're talking about a film that will chronicle the history of a local landmark. Diana Sole is the president/owner of Motion Masters, a film company out of the Charleston, West Virginia area, and they're working on a film about Blennerhassett Island. Diana, welcome to the program today.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
What kind of work does Motion Masters do? Let's go ahead and start there. Tell us about your company.
Motion Masters is celebrating its 33rd year in business now, and we began primarily as a firm that did corporate video production. And we still do that work, and we do a fair amount of that work. But we also got into time periods each year where the corporate work sort of died off. You might not think about the video production business being cyclical like you would a construction firm, but it very much has its ebbs and flows. And so I looked for a way for us to have some work to do when the corporate work got quiet. For example, like during the holiday period, because I still had equipment and I still had staff, and I needed to put them to good use. So about 20 years ago, we started producing educational media, documentary type productions on a wide range of subjects that are using classrooms to augment textbooks. We have a distributor who's in New York. It's the North America's largest distributor of educational media. And we got a lot of accolades for our work in that arena. And we also won a lot of national awards for our work in that arena. And that put me in touch with the world of documentary filmmaking. And I looked into, like, how do documentaries get done? How do they get funded? What's the licensing requirements? All sorts of things. And we started doing documentary work as well. So our first documentary that was broadcast on public broadcasting was a biography of Leon Sullivan. If you drive through Charleston, you go past Leon Sullivan Way. And I'm proud to say that that was a direct result of our documentary about Reverend Sullivan. It's the former Broad Street. And after the documentary, the city of Charleston chose to rename that street for Leon Sullivan. And so that was our first one. It was a hurdle to get done. I had many people tell me to give it up. It wouldn't get done. I grew up with rather a stubborn streak, as my parents would tell you. And I was determined to tell the story, and so wouldn't let it rest until I had. And I'm real proud of that piece. It aired nationally on what's called the PBS Hard Schedule, which is the schedule that they use at stations all over the country. It's not a, you can run this if you choose to. It is in the hard schedule. That was our first one. So we kind of hit a home run with that. And I've continued to do documentary work ever since. So now we do the corporate work and we do the educational media work and we do documentary work.
What are some of the other subjects of documentaries you've tackled?
Well, I'm fascinated by the stories of people. And so I also did a biography of Senator Byrd called Soul of the Senate. And that one was an interesting one to do. It was a direct contrast with the one we had done on Leon Sullivan, who nobody really knew much about. And Senator Byrd, we'd kind of all grown up with Senator Byrd in office in one capacity or another. And so people felt like they knew him. So I had to bring new information and new insight to the biography. I also have done one on the history of West Virginia's capitals, which is very interesting about its bouncing between Charleston and Wheeling and Charleston and Wheeling and back to Charleston. And how did Charleston end up being the state capital? That one was a fascinating one to do. I also did one on the history of the oil and gas industry in West Virginia. All the ideas come from a variety of sources, but that one in particular came from reading the book written by David McCain, who was the founder of the Oil and Gas Museum in Parkersburg. David wrote the book Where It All Began. And when I read that book and I read some of the history he had compiled, I was quite surprised at so many firsts that had occurred here in West Virginia, or then Western Virginia. So I worked with David to produce a documentary about that. It's called Burning Springs, and it's a pretty fascinating piece about an industry that is very tied to the formation of our state and, of course, has had a resurgence in recent years as well.
What kind of story can you tell through a documentary, or what can you do through a documentary that maybe you can't do through other mediums?
What you can do with a documentary as opposed to a book is lift the story out and add dimension to it that you don't get just with the written word. You know, you can have voice actors read parts that are central characters to a story. You can add sound effects. You add a narrator who carries you through the story and the plot of the story. And it's really how young people like to learn, too. You give somebody a choice between, here, let's read this book about, in this case, the Blennerhassetts, or let's watch this documentary about the Blennerhassetts. The story comes so much more to life when you can add visuals to it and audio to it and music to it so that it captures the imagination and hopefully takes you right into the heart of the setting and the time period.
What appeals to you about the Blennerhassett story?
Well, interestingly enough, I did a video, it's about 10 minutes in length, for the Blennerhassett Museum very early on in my career. As a matter of fact, that piece was done more than 30 years ago and is still in use today. Now, you might say the history hasn't changed. It's a short piece, it's 10 minutes. That doesn't give you a lot of time to give the backstory and to delve into, you know, what was happening in the Western frontier, which is where we're located at that time. I mean, it's really just an executive summary of what the Blennerhassett's significance is. I had done that piece 30 odd years ago. And when I was finished with my documentary on Katherine Johnson, and I was looking for, you know, what subject do I want to dive into next? I was ready to go back into history a little further. The outlier piece on Catherine is much more contemporary. So I thought of the Blennerhassetts, and I did my research, and I realized that story had never been told in full-length documentary form. And I thought, this is perfect. It's a wonderful story. It has a historical significance to our state, but also to the nation because of Blennerhassett's role in the whole treason trial, and which was at that point called the trial of the century. I looked into it and decided, okay, you know, that's what I want to spend the next couple of years working on.
In Parkersburg, it's a name that's on at least one roadway. It's a name that's on a school. It's a name that's on a state park. But to use a contemporary term, these folks were movers and shakers, weren't they?
Oh, they absolutely were. You think about the time period where Harmon and Margaret left their ancestral homes and traveled across the Atlantic Ocean on a voyage that took 72 days. Now you think about the ship and that journey. That was a huge voyage, you know, to come to this country. They were in Philadelphia, they were in New York, and then decided to make their way to the Western frontier. I mean, we have to remember the time period they came here was just a few years after, you know, the last Indian warfare had taken place. I mean, this really was the frontier. And they were quite bold to make their way to this country and then make their way to the edge of civilization, which is what it was then.
We'll return to our conversation with Diana Soul of Motion Masters about their upcoming Blennerhassett Island documentary. But first, this break, you're listening to Mid-Ohio Valley Now. Welcome back to Mid-Ohio Valley Now. Again, I'm your host, Eric Little. Thank you for joining us once again this morning. Let's rejoin our conversation with Diana Soul of Motion Masters about their upcoming documentary about the Blennerhassetts. How do you find this story fits in with the kind of project you've done before?
Each of the projects we've done, obviously, good storytelling has a central character or characters. This one has three very interesting characters. I'm calling it the Blennerhassetts, but of course there's also Aaron Burr, one of the founding fathers of our country, who had been held in great esteem until he and the president, under whom he had served as vice president, got into crosshairs, and Burr was ultimately charged with treason and how Harmon was dragged into it and things of that sort. So all good stories have good, strong characters. And the stories of Harmon and Margaret Blennerhassett and Aaron Burr, you know, provide good characters to portray in the storyline. Also, you know, you have the setting. Well, the setting of Blennerhassett Island, the paradise that they created there. At the time they built it, it was the grandest estate west of the Allegheny Mountains. There are books written in which people describe what it was like to come down the Ohio River and see this magnificent home in the middle of the absolute primeval forest. So you have a fabulous setting. And of course, we're able to take advantage of the recreated home that is there on the island. So we will be over there this spring doing a lot of videography.
I was about to ask you that next. How far along in the filmmaking process are you?
We have one interview in the can, as we say. We have shot an interview with Nancy Eisenberg. Nancy is the author of the book Fallen Founder, which was about Burr and the entire saga of what happened, who he was, and how he came to be charged with treason, and whether or not being charged with treason was political or was it something that had truth to it. So she is one of the definitive academics on Burr, and we shot her interview just before Christmas. We have a couple of other interview requests out for other historians to join the storyline in this piece. And then, as I said, we'll be out shooting a lot of footage as soon as West Virginia greens up. The gray, rainy days of winter is no time to be shooting in West Virginia.
Has it been difficult to find source materials and information for this film? Again, it's a topic that happened more than 200 years ago. Where has that process led you?
If you look around my office, you'll see a lot of books, and you'll see a lot of very old books as well. I have been reading everything from Transportation in the Ohio Valley to Sapphire's book about the Blennerhassetts to booklets written by Dr. Ray Swick, retired now, a historian for West Virginia State Parks and the Blennerhassett Museum in particular. A lot of research has already gone into it. We've already obtained a lot of historical archive visual material because, and this is where writing a book would be easier, because you can write a book and not have to have a visual to illustrate what you're talking about. And of course, when you're doing a documentary, something visually has to be on the screen. Mm-hmm. And that's something visually on the screen has to change every 3 to 5 seconds or so in order to hold the viewer's attention. So you have to find historical documents, historical maps. In this case, this story precedes photography. So, you know, we can't go back and find photographs, but there are silhouettes available of Harmon and Margaret. We've been gathering as much material as we can. So That's what we've been doing in preparation for the principal videography work.
What's been the hardest part of telling this story or working on the film to this point?
Fundraising. Fundraising is always the hardest part for a documentary producer. And I think people don't really understand that when our work airs on public broadcasting, we're not paid for that. It is an honor for our work to be broadcast, and I'm very proud to say that public broadcasting's highest nights of viewership are when local documentaries run, and ours in particular have been very successful for them in drawing viewers. And they run our documentaries multiple times a year for multiple years. The one I was talking about earlier about Reverend Leon Sullivan, that piece is approximately 20 years old, and they still run it regularly. Mm-hmm. I know it's running right now because I got a phone call from my aunt who lives in Weirton, West Virginia, to tell me she'd just seen it again. So I'm really proud of that, but it doesn't return revenue. I have a staff to pay. I have rights I have to pay. There's narrators to pay, voice actors to pay. You have to go out and raise money from organizations and foundations who are willing to support that particular project. So far, we've been really blessed. The Blennerhassett Historical Foundation made a significant contribution to the project. The Bernard McDonough Foundation has also contributed. And then we have contributions as well from the Parkersburg Convention and Visitors Bureau and from United Bank. So right now, we're under a third of our fundraising goal for the documentary, but there's no question that's the hardest part. And every time I do a documentary, I think this one, it's going to be so much easier to raise money for whatever reason. And each time I find it to be a slugfest. Yeah. We work on the projects as funds are available for the project. So it's kind of happens in a parallel fashion. And so we're actively fundraising and then planning for videography work.
So the city officials, community officials, the leaders in the area, there has been some support, but you'd like to see more.
Oh, absolutely. We definitely need more corporate support or from any quarter that we can get it. It takes a significant sum of money to bring a documentary to the screen. We're in active fundraising mode right now, writing grants. I have a coworker she is our senior producer, Diane Dimoff, who spends a great deal of her time applying for grants and responding to them with all the necessary documents they need for that particular project. The University of Charleston has served as our fiscal sponsor for the last several of our productions, which means donations go to the University of Charleston, which is a 501c3. Some foundations only give to other foundations. foundations or 501c3s, and UC administers the funds, and as we work on it, we invoice the University of Charleston. So they serve as the repository for the funds.
So basically, for someone in our listening audience today that is interested in providing some financial backing, the thing to do would be get in touch with you, and you would be able to lay the groundwork for how they need to do that. How do they reach out to you and get in touch with you?
They can find us on our website, motionmasters.com. We have a staff directory on there, and they can reach out to Diana, which is me, or Diane Dimoff, which is our senior producer, and we can get them the necessary information in order to make the contribution to the University of Charleston.
When we come back, we'll wrap up our conversation with Diana Sole of Motion Masters about their upcoming documentary on the Blennerhassetts. But first, this break, you're listening to Mid-Ohio Valley Now. Welcome back to Mid-Ohio Valley Now. Again, I'm your host, Eric Little. Let's wrap up our conversation with Diana Sole of Motion Masters about the new documentary on the Blennerhassetts. So what can we expect from the film based on what's been done so far?
I have a script treatment already prepared, but I will tell you that story evolves as you work on it as well. So I have some sound bites I've already selected from Nancy Eisenberg, but our interview with her is over 2 hours long.
Yeah.
It's a fabulous interview, and selecting only those portions that I can fit into either a 60 or a 90 minute documentary is tough. It's tough to cut things down. As I said, I have several other interview requests out. I'd like to get my interviews shot, and then what I'll do is I'll go back and redraft my script. And as my work continues and my research continues, that script will continue to unfold. And, you know, the narrative will weave in and out of the sound bites that we've selected. I will find that in most cases when I'm working, say, on an hour-long documentary, I write and I pick my sound bites. And when I do what is called a stringer, which is where we just lay down a scratch track of narration with the sound bites inserted into it to get a feel for the actual length of the documentary. Each time I think I'm writing an hour long piece, I find I'm writing about an hour and 20 minutes or an hour and 30 minutes. And then I have to go back and start cutting and cutting and cutting. And that gets to be quite painful as a writer. It's like, no, I have to have that sentence. It's such an essential sentence. You get down to where you are subtracting words in order to make something fit. And I have to leave appropriate pauses and segues for music bridges. And that sound, the narrator can't talk, or somebody can't be talking for 58 minutes and 30 seconds. Thank you very much. Solid. The piece has to have breathing spaces in it as well. Right. So it's a process, and that will continue to unfold up until almost the last days of editing.
What have you been most surprised by or interested to learn about the Blennerhassetts, either through the original film or through the research for this film?
Well, I was surprised to find out they came through Pennsylvania and Pittsburgh about the same time that some of my ancestors were arriving in that area. I've kind of gotten into some family genealogy work as I've worked on this particular project, and it's been interesting. I also, of course, read David McCullough's book on the pioneers and learning more about the time period and what was here. I guess I knew enough about the Blennerhassetts story, enough of it to know what that was and why it was an important part of American history, because we had done that piece 30 years ago. But now I have the luxury of time to develop the context in which all this was occurring and to spend time on some of the other characters that were central to the story. So that's been interesting.
What's your expected release date for the film?
We would love to be able to release the film later this year, but it all comes back to fundraising. It's not unusual at all for these things to take multiple years to get done, because it takes a long time. Sometimes foundations that you're applying to for funding only have one or two cycles a year where they do grants. So, you know, you're waiting for that to come back around as well. If we had the funding in hand today, we could have a release by the end of 2020. More likely, it's going to be 2021 before we're able to have the funding necessary to pull it all together and complete the piece.
Once it's finished, are there plans in the works for a premiere in the Mid-Ohio Valley?
Oh, absolutely. We'll do a premiere at the Smoot Theater. We're all looking forward to that. The Blennerhassett Hotel wants to run it in a loop on their system. I'd like to see a movie night on the island where we could play it as well, and people could watch it there. So there'll be a big shebang, and we've always have a premiere here in Charleston as well, typically at the Culture Center, where people can come and watch. So it'll be a big shebang when we go to release it. We'll release it. It will run on public broadcasting statewide, and then we will also look for other outlets to broadcast it. There's some possibility, depending upon how much of the piece I can focus on their time in Europe, that I could get international distributor interested in it airing there. The piece we did on Katherine Johnson, Outlier, has now been picked up in Switzerland, Sweden, and Spain. I don't know why all the S's, but that's where it has currently been broadcast. And I think the Blennerhassetts story has some legs that might get an international distributor interested as well. So we're going to aim for that. We'll see how that goes, and then the timing of its release on Amazon Prime as well. Our documentaries are all available on Amazon Prime. You just can go in and type in Motion Masters, and it'll give you a menu of the productions that we have done. We're real proud of that. We're real proud to be able to bring it to an audience, because people who are interested in history outside of West Virginia should have the opportunity to see these as well. Plus, we all know that there's a big number of people out there in the West Virginia diaspora, as I would say.
Extended family.
Exactly. And they are able to watch these productions as well.
West Virginia is more than just the 1.9 million people who are currently in the state, isn't it?
Absolutely. I have children of my own who are living out of state. You know, they're able to sit down with Amazon Prime and watch historical pieces about our state.
What's the best way for people to keep up to date on the latest with this project?
We're not as good as putting things up on our web pages. We should be, probably. But there are some things on our blog about the project and where we are with the project. We have had a lot of media interest from the Parkersburg and Mid-Ohio Valley area. Maybe we'll be able to come back on your show, for example, and be talking about it when it's ready to be released.
Well, we'd love to have you back, for one. And for two, the fact that this is an over 200-year-old story and people from the Parkersburg area still care so much about the Blennerhassetts, what's that say to you?
I think that West Virginians have a great pride in the history of their state. And we like to honor that history, whether it's Shepherdstown and the history that has occurred over there, or some of the what's occurred in Wheeling. Wheeling's very proud of its role in West Virginia's history. And you just go around the state and you realize that we're all very proud of what we have here and who has come from here, which is why some of the biographies I've done have been so well received. There's a great sense of pride in the Parkersburg story. I also want to give huge credit to Dr. Raymond Zwick, who's made that his passion, the story of the Blennerhassetts and collecting information and collecting artifacts and that museum and the state park. I mean, he kept that story alive. Kudos to him.
Well, to touch on that thought, when we come from this area, do we sometimes forget to know, recognize, and understand the history right in front of us? Like, we are all familiar with the name Blennerhasset, but to really dig in and know what that means, what they did, who they were, do we sometimes forget that? And will this film fill in the gaps for people?
I think we do forget it, and I think we take it for granted. I mean, I've already talked to how many people who live in Parkersburg or have lived at one time or another in Parkersburg who tell me, you know, I never actually made it over to the island. You know, it's New Yorkers, I guess, don't make it to the Statue of Liberty. I mean, you know, it's not just something that's unique to us. When I did the documentary about the history of the West Virginia capitals, people could vaguely remember something about that back in West Virginia history classes they might have had in middle school, for example, but they learned so much more through the documentary, and it brought it to life for them. And that's really what we're after. We're trying to engage people in the stories of the people who are founders of our state, stories of the people who have led incredible lives, stories about time periods in West Virginia that were critical to how we were shaped and formed and why we are who we are today. That's what is my passion. I love West Virginia history. My family dates back before the French and Indian War in the state, with multiple patriots in my family tree, some of whom were some of the earliest residents of West Virginia. And I think stories like this Blennerhassett one are enchanting, they are inspiring, and you'll learn a few things in the meantime, too.
Diana Sole is the president and owner of Motion Masters, a company in the Charleston area that's working on a Blennerhassett Island documentary. And if you want to see this sooner than later, fall 2020, winter 2020, going into 2021, then you want to get behind that and fund that. The website for more information one more time.
Motionmasters.com.
Diana, thank you so much for joining us to talk about the project, your passion for the project, and good luck to you as you continue to work on this and raise funds.
Thank you. We're really looking forward to it. I can't wait to get on the island and start shooting this spring.
That's our time. I'm your host, Derek Little. Thank you for listening. We'll talk to you next week on another edition of Mid-Ohio Valley Now.